Hello everyone and welcome to this channel. Welcome to the Sabbath Prep Friday, where basically we surrender something. And so as you know, we are still on the 90-Day Destiny Transformation Series. And today I believe it is number 40. And so today we will be talking about false safety, the fear of death, the missing ingredient, and forgiveness. And so I really want to jump right in. I'm already like 2 days late because today actually is Saturday, but I had some technical difficulties. I'm glad you didn't give up on me. And so I want to respect your time and get right into this message. And so, we can be done. So welcome, 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 everyone. Welcome. So what I realize is that sometimes when we are traumatized, abused, mistreated, lied on, cheated, we are left with behaviors that we were forced into a lot of times that impacts our life in the most negative way. However, those same behaviors come with messages. I know for me it did. You know, I told y'all a lot of times that, I was made to eat. And while I believe that food is like the worst addiction that you can have, because while you don't have to have sex, you don't have to do drugs, you don't have to do alcohol or whatever it is that we can possibly else that we can be addicted to, we do have to eat. And so, you know, just like with other things that we can be addicted to, food has triggers, you know, that can cause you to get into other things. And there are some trouble foods for me, and I try to stay away from them. However, it's not what this video is all about. Okay, so basically, I want to talk about like cherished sins, secret sins, those sins that we indulge in as a result of the fear of death, okay? And so, you know, I looked it up. Check out my other YouTube, which is The Pursuit of Christ, and a playlist on that YouTube and this one, which is Shula Ministries Overcomers Anonymous. So, okay, so you know I looked it up. And so I have information mainly from the Oxford Dictionary, but I also have something from the Merriam-Webster as well. So, okay, so I looked up cherished sins. Not sins, because we know sin is a transgression of the law. In other words, out of touch, disobedient to the word of God, mainly the Ten Commandments in short. So the Oxford Dictionary says that to cherish is to protect and to care for lovingly, to hold dear and to keep a hope or ambition in one's mind. Okay. And then when I looked up secret sins, well, just secret, I already defined sins, but secret, it says that it is to not make something known or seen by someone or by others, you know, not meant to be seen by others, or something kept or meant to be kept unknown or unseen by others. Now, to me, that was the same thing, but it had two different definitions. And when I wrote, I was like, what? This is saying the same thing. Now, this one right here, this one's saying that, this is from the Merriam Dictionary on secret sins, or secret, not sins, just secrets. And it says something kept hidden or unexplained, like a mystery. Something kept from others' knowledge, or something that is confidently shared just with a few people. It could be like a method, some kind of formula, that maybe that people may use in art, or some kind of company. Some kind of craft or something like that. Okay. In this case, we're talking about sin. Okay. Cherish sin. And so I would like to venture into say, like, how something gets to be cherished. Now, pretty much all my life, you couldn't tell me that I didn't cherish food. Now, I was basically forced to eat, and I was even whipped to make to eat. I mean, I was still a short person, but I was a small person to the point where you could see my bones. But I felt good in my stomach. I had enough. I ate what I wanted, what I didn't want. I didn't eat it. At first, it was okay. However, I don't know if y'all know about, like, I want to say Pavlov's dog, or I think it was something. Yeah, I think it was Pavlov's dog, but they rang the bell, the dog salivated, whatever, they gave it food. Then it got to the point where they could ring the bell only, and then the dog would still salivate for food, okay? It's kind of sort of like that. When we've been forced into a behavior, the person that forced us don't even necessarily have to be around. But however, we can have fears from remembering a situation in our minds and in our hearts, you know. And so while we may love and care for the person that forced us into it, we initially, we hated the thing that we were forced in, be it alcohol, drugs, sex. A lot of times it's sex, okay? And I know that you might say, well, she always talking about sex. Listen, I talk about the thing that most of us have been mostly impacted by. You know, we've been impacted also by verbal abuse, physical abuse as well, okay? But however, whatever the thing is, it could become cherished. It appears that it's cherished. And in reality, a lot of times it's because maybe we conformed. In other words, we cooperated because we was afraid what would happen if we didn't, okay? And so while we may have cherished the person that brought us into it, now that maybe that person is not around, then that particular sin, you know, and if you are confused about what sin is, check out 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, I believe it's verses 9 to 11. And God talks about, like, the ungodly is not going to inherit the kingdom of heaven. And it lists a bunch of sins. But the humbling thing that I like about it is where it talks about, and you were once like this, basically. The scripture will be in the description, which is the arrow next to the title, okay? And so basically, in Shula Ministries, we do what we do because of Jesus Christ and what he's sacrificed for us on the cross. Therefore, our completeness, our wholeness, our forgiveness, our cleanliness, all the things that we thought were impossible becomes possible with Jesus Christ. But we need to be obedient to his word. And I encourage the King James Version because it's what he encouraged me. The Ten Commandments, where he admonishes us to keep the seventh day Sabbath, okay? So this will be all in the description, which is the arrow next to the title. So, okay, and so what I looked up in the Bible about, like, sins that we do because of the fear of death. And so abuses fall into that. You know, maybe we learned something vicariously. In other words, we watched our father be beaten by our mother, or our mother be beaten by our father, or a parent fighting another partner or something, or older sibling or something. And so we learn something vicariously. And so when a person comes up on us, we cooperate because we don't want the same beaten. Or maybe something happened to us particular. But regardless of what it is, the Bible says that we have deliverance, okay? And that deliverance basically is in Jesus. You know, it's like the Bible talks about him having overcome this world, that in this world we're going to have tribulations. And that's one of the things that the Lord used to settle me when I was trying to overcome the aftermath of my young person being victimized, that Sheila, this is planet Earth. These things that we are bound by, we would not be bound by them when Jesus comes, because we're going to be changed, okay? And so in us, him changing us, those things, when we accept him in and we endeavor like to hold on to him, like no matter what, like the Bible talks about us enduring till the end. And this work that Christ started in us, what God started in us, he will finish until Jesus comes. And so as we commit those things to him, and I know that, let me finish that statement. As we commit those things to him, everything that we commit to Christ, he will keep. He will help us, okay? But we have to commit those things. Okay. And so, when I think about when I looked in the Bible, that's what I start to tell you, that I looked in the Bible and it talks about that God through Christ has even delivered us from, things that we were subject to for our lifetime that kept us in bondage due to the fear of death. And so a lot of times when we were traumatized as children. And a lot of times by adults that were sick, confused, needing the healing of Jesus Christ. Okay. And so as a result, they brought us into those things. And so we stayed, we cooperated because of fear. And we stayed because of fear. Fear of what? Fear of if we don't do it, that maybe we will get killed. Maybe we won't get love, affection, and attention. Whatever reason why, comment down below your reason why you cooperated if something bad happened to you. And why afterwards, when you were no longer subject to those environments, why you continued on. Because see, what happens is a lot of times is we begin to get addicted while we're trying to cope. But no matter the situation, when the temptation or we're triggered, you know, I can remember like going in certain areas, feeling mainly anxiety because of the abuse that I had experienced, and having to say the 23rd Psalms, the Lord, like under my breath, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pasture. When it gets to the part where it talks about, though I walk through the shadow. And the reason why it's a shadow is because it's not the real thing. It's the remembrance of what we actually went through. And the Bible says, I will fear no evil. Why? Because thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And so a lot of times what happens is that when we cooperated, we took on basically a fake or false safety in performing whatever it is that our perpetrator wanted us to form. It was a false safety. And I read in the word, and it was talking about like that whosoever listens to God, they will dwell in safety and will be secure from the fear of death. Okay. And so when I talk about like a missing ingredient, the thing that I have learned is that forgiveness is like a healing balm, B-A-L-M, yeah, B-A-L-M, not B-O-M-B, B-A-L-M, like an ointment or something, like a healing balm. And what comes to mind is the story about the guy that was brought to Jesus having palsy. And so basically Jesus said, you know, your sins be forgiven you, take up your bed and walk. And so the elders and the scribes or whoever they were that was standing around, they would say, blasphemy, blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God? You know, and Jesus said basically that He wants us to know that there is forgiveness, or that he has the power to forgive on this earth. And so forgiveness does a couple things. Forgiveness both is like, it unleashes us. It unleashes the person that we're upset with, okay? Now, they have to get their own forgiveness, but at least we can forgive us. And when we forgive, God starts to heal us. Healing can take place when we have forgiveness. So forgiveness is not just for us, but it's also for us to share with all those people that has offended us. Now, we all offend. Every last one of us, we all offend. So it's a constantly a situation where we forgive and are forgiven. We forgive and are forgiven. And this right here is a part of the Christian faith, because the Bible says that if we don't forgive, that our Heavenly Father will not forgive us. Yeah, so, okay, so what do we do with the story? Don't keep repeating the story. You know, tell a couple people, deal with it in between you and God, deal with it in therapy. But as we keep on telling the story, it keeps it alive in us to the point where we're not able to partake of the life that God has for us, of healing, abundance, prosperity, a success, and all those different things, okay? And so basically, when I think about a cherished sin, I think about David. Now, David had a bunch of wives. And so basically, you know, when he went out for Bathsheba, you know, it appears that the only thing that he feared was her husband, Uriah. Okay. And so the Bible talks about different things that he did to Uriah and basically having him killed. Well, when Nathan the prophet came to David, he let him know that the person that he was fearing was the wrong person. And so a lot of times in our sin, or in our, you know, when we've been traumatized and we continue the things that we were traumatized in, we're fearing the wrong person. The person that we should fear is God. Why? Because while the other person may be able to kill our body, they cannot kill our body and our soul. Okay. And so regardless of what we go through on this earth is not going to compare to the joy, the glory that God will reveal in us. You know, sometimes in this life for some of us, and then sometimes only in the afterlife when Christ shall come seen in a cloud of glory. In that life, when he would destroy the wicked with Satan, and those that are alive and remain and is part of his kingdom, you know, that when they died, they were a Christian. I mean, a Christian. They followed God. They did what they were supposed to do for the best of their ability. And God knew it. They did their best. Those people will be going to heaven with God. And so I thought that this was very important for us to talk about, is because if we do not accept what Christ died for us to have, if we do not accept the forgiveness for ourselves and for the people that offend us, there's no more hope for us. There is no more hope for us. Let me go a little bit further. When I think of secret sins, I think about Judah. Now, I believe that Judah was maybe, I want to say, the fourth or fifth son of Jacob. And Judah, being an honorable man, he used to secretly sleep with prostitutes, okay, with whores, you know. And so, you know, if you know the whole story, it'll be in the description where you can find it. But if you know the story, he had several sons and he had one daughter-in-law. And at that time, what would happen is when one son died, you know, she can marry the next son, the next son, the next son. And so that had happened until it got to Judah's last son. And I think his name was Shelah. I'm not sure what the name was. Sounds something like my name. But anyway, he was his last child. But what happened was each time the husband from Judah, one of his sons, slept with, I think her name was Tamar. Don't quote me on that. But slept with her, they spilled the semen on the bed. In other words, what they were supposed to do is to raise up an inheritance to their brother, whose wife she was originally was. But because they did not do that, they sinned against God and died, destroyed them immediately. And so had Shelah did the same thing, Judah wouldn't have had no children. So in desperation, Tamar got herself, she knew that Judah was going on. She got herself all dressed up and everything. She took off her widow's garment and she dressed herself up as this prostitute or whatever. And when Judah went out to secretly sleep with what he thought was a whore, he slept with his daughter, his daughter-in-law. And he promised her that he was going to bring back payment or whatever for what she had did for him. And so basically, she made him leave behind, I think it was his rod and his staff or whatever it was that he had, so that she could be sure that he comes back when they can do a swap, I guess. You give me the money, I'll give you your stuff, whatever the case was. But however, the point that I want to make, perhaps Judah was afraid of the big wheels finding him out, you know, the other leaders and stuff and the nobles and all that of Israel, to know that he was secretly sleeping around with whores. Let me tell you something. There's no such thing as a secret. God will reveal every secret. Not only God, but why do you think that the prisons are full? Because Satan will reveal secrets too. He don't care nothing about us, whether we do right or whether we do wrong. He hates our stinking guts, okay? And so we have to get to the point to where we trust God. We trust God. And it is in trusting God, being obedient to his will and being obedient to his way and the examples that Christ left for us to follow, are we truly safe? However, when we continue on in the abuses that we were bought into, that's a fake and false safety. It's not really safe, because when Christ comes, the ungodly is not going to go with him. And it may appear that our perpetrator has gotten away with something, but they have not. They have not. God will, as he said, avenge us, our enemies. And that's another reason why we can be free and move on. He knows all about what has happened to us. He knows and he cares. But however, he wants us to be with him. And the only way is that we accept. He's not going to force us into to anything. Now, all things are possible through Christ. All things. Now, remember my food fundraisers, okay? You know, check it out. My information is in the description for the food fundraisers, vegan meat alternatives, a size 9 dairy ice cream, and other desserts. Veganism has a great rep, y'all. It can reverse disease. It can prevent diseases. It can help us to hold on to those good young genes and also help us with longevity. So check it out for a week, for a month, however you choose. And I try to make it finger licking good and also the prices reasonable, so check that out. Okay, and so yes, it's very, very important. So okay, I think it was one more person that I wanted to talk about. Did Judah and the guy that had palsy. Now, when I think it was the scribes, Pharisees, because you know they were always around trying to catch Jesus doing something wrong. Basically, when Jesus said, you know, take up your bed and walk, I like that, because he said, what difference does it make? I can either say, take up the bed and walk, or your sins be forgiven. Take up your bed and walk means that for a person that has palsy and can't walk, that means you're healed. For a person, you know, forgiveness, that means that everything that you did, and a lot of times we do stuff to bring sin on ourselves. Our situation, a lot of times, even if we have been mistreated or whatever, we believe the lies about it that says you're nothing, you're nobody, this is what you deserve, you don't deserve nothing better. When we believe those things, Satan is so happy. But when we cast off those things and receive the forgiveness and the healing of God, we are free to live the life that He's created, you know, sanctified us for and ordained us for, okay? And my prayer is that we will lay down false safety, connect up with Christ, okay? Connect with God in the name of Jesus. Accept the forgiveness for ourselves and the people that wronged us, and live the life that Christ died for us to live. You're going to want to subscribe because we're going fast. Like I said, we are on 40. You know, share the video, encourage subscription as you share. And remember to comment and to give me some thumbs up. Thumbs up helps the YouTube. It lets me know what you like. And it gives me the confidence to keep putting out great videos. Okay. So the missing ingredient, forgiveness. Forgiveness, because with forgiveness, not only do we have our sins thrown in the depth of the sea where God remembers them no more, but we also have healing from forgiveness. Because as we forgive others, we don't repeat those things from the stories that we're telling about what has happened to us. You know, we can tell it for somebody else's learning and be free from it. You know, it'd be like a distant memory. Okay, so basically, I believe that that's all I have for you. I'll try to have as much as I can in the description. Okay, so I love you. Now, to Him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. I love you. See you in the next YouTube.